I kind of felt there would be something amazing happen today because it was amazing weather, amazing day, 87 degrees, sparkling, warm, just this wow, April 5th day, and it just started out just fabulous, fabulous. I can tell you this little story. You're gonna, you know, it's just, this is what happened. The day was one of the more amazing days, maybe the most amazing day I've ever had in my life, actually. And I hardly know what to say, but I can say this. Starts out where I go in to buy something, and there's no barcode on the product, and it's not in the computer. And the clerk at the register just trying so hard to find this. I can't find this. I can't find this anywhere. And I'm just sitting there waiting. What's he gonna do? What's he gonna do? What's he gonna do? And he looks at me and he takes it and puts my product, boom, on the counter in front of me. He says, "It's yours." And I wanted to say, like, "Oh, no, I can't do that." I didn't say that. What I said to him was, I said, "You know what?" As I was leaving, I said, "You know what? 99.99% of people in the world would never do that." And he looked at me and said, "Yeah, I know." And I said, "Mark of the beast, no one can buy or sell without the mark of the beast. The stripes on a barcode refer to the stripes on animals, beasts. It's called the mark of the beast. No one can buy or sell without that barcode, right? If you can't, if it's not in the computer, they scan it, they won't sell it to you." But he said, "Hey, I can't find it, so take it." It's like, and I walked out of there. I was just like walking on air. And I walked out on this beautiful California morning. I just said, "What just happened? That's never happened to me before. Nobody, if they can't find a SKU or something, nobody just gave, he just gave it to me. His expensive item, he just gave it to me." He said, "It's not in here. So who cares?" He says, "Who cares? It's not in here. And maybe I'm not in the computer. I'm not a part of the Mark of the Beast civilization, am I?" He said, "You're free. You know, you're free. Take it. Take it." Good Lord. I just wanted the experience. It was worth the experience. It just blew my mind because you realize how trapped we are now and how extraordinary, unusual this is. So that started the day. The day kind of ended. The workday came to an end where this man asked me, "Do you have this tool to use this thing?" And I said, "No." And he says, "Wait a minute." Went to his truck, pulled the tool out, fixed, got it all ready for you. He says, "Here, take it." I said, "What?" Well, you know, I was in the mood like, okay, if somebody wants to give me something, I'll take it. He says, "Yeah, take it, take it, take it. You can call me later when you're done with it. I'll come and get it. No problem." And he said, "Here." And he gave me this product that we're using it. And he said, "Here, take another one. Take an extra one. Here." And I just, okay. So those are the bookends to the day. In between, I had the most amazing flipping the script experiences that I've ever had in my life. And I said, "Okay, wow. Full stop in the wow. What else are you going to do? Seriously, what else are you going to do? You might as well get used to this practice because there's really nothing else you can do." Just trust in the momentum, right? Just trust it. You have to trust. You have to have faith. You have to trust in the Holy Spirit. I'm trying to take in 101 and tried to go to Oakland, and it's just the traffic's just horrible. I mean, the traffic today was so hostile and horrible. It was just 130 miles zigzagging around all day in this traffic, and I just like beat up. And I'm trying to get over to, oh man, you know, I said, "Oh, how am I going to do this? I've never taken this exit before, this particular one, for some reason." And you have to keep getting over and over and over and over. I said, "Oh my gosh." Well, there's this white truck and it just stops and gives me this huge space to get over. It was just the way it happened. I said, "Wow, the Holy Spirit must have just stopped him. I don't know what he was doing." It's like the Holy Spirit was with me the whole day. Jesus said, if you commit, If you commit to truth, the Holy Spirit will go before you and remove every obstacle before you even get there. Every obstacle will be removed. He says, I promise you this is the truth. So it's a day of commitment. I said, let's commit. Let's commit. It's the year of commitment. 2016 is the year of commitment. Now, the flipping the script today, it just put me in a different realm, really, a different boat. You just so I just had to, you know, wow, again, this is what I always do. It's necessary. It's necessary. You just have to take it and be grateful for it, and say okay, and just accept it. This is meant to be. It's meant to be. It's meant to be. And just maintain your poise. Great, we're all meant for greatness, okay? So there's nothing we can do about it. God's going to catch us, okay? So you just got to get caught, that's all. So I'm just in this process of being caught by God. We don't catch God, God catches us. It's like that, really. As long as we're trying to catch God, we'll never find God. As soon as we give up trying to find God, God catches us. Because God's everywhere. As soon as we're seeking God, God's lost to us. It implies that God is not everywhere, doesn't it? So, I'm just giving up, you know, the seeking of God, giving it up. And then here comes this, some of these clarifications that you know, rocked my boat tremendously. And it just fundamentally changes my life. Fundamentally changes it, yeah. There's no getting around it, yeah. My life has been changed. There's no question about it. So I just full stop on the wow, okay? Driving through this traffic helps, you know. You got to stay focused. It's not really traffic. It's mayhem. And I was talking to this young man. He was a clerk at a store. They're talking about the day and driving. He's young. He's very young. And he said he spoke right up. He says, "Look, I know what it is. It's the youth. It's the youth." I told him there's so many young people in Silicon Valley. It's all these drivers are young. He said, "Yeah, you're right. It's the youth is just completely dominates here, and we drive too fast. We drive too aggressive. We drive on the edge, dangerously. You know, it's just all this stuff." And he says, "This is causes problems for everybody else." He says, "I don't like it." He says, "I'm very aware of it." I said, "Oh, wow, really?" He said, "Yeah." This is a young man who's very aware, great perspective, very bright looking person, very great perspective, and it's too intense here, you know. It's too intense. Everybody's on espresso, everybody's 25 and making, you know, $300,000 a year, everybody's in fast cars, and everybody is late to make their millions. Everybody's after the millions, and you just, the place is just humming with this, you know, edginess, and trying to hang with that at my age is ridiculous. It's just every day is like a blitzkrieg. It's just insane. And the cars are coming at you from every angle. You can't get away. Everybody's on your tail. You try to turn in the parking lot. There's always somebody coming out. And you're just like squeezing here, squeezing there. It's like you're being squeezed everywhere. It never lets up. It never lets up. I said, just just in an open road, if it opens up at any point, you just like feel, oh, it's like bliss. Traffic was jammed up, and then for some reason, some spot, somehow it opened up, and we're going, and there's space between cars, and I was just like, I was like, oh, this is just beautiful. This is so beautiful. I yelled, I was screaming, this is great. And then about a mile or two later, boom, everything stopped, just gridlock again. I was like, oh, back into hell here. Yeah, but all the while, you know, I'm just writing this intense wow of the script flipping that happened. So the moral of the story is don't give up. Wherever you are, this is the most difficult time in history of this planet. Nothing even comes close. It's totally insanely off the charts right now, globally, actually. In the Silicon Valley, it may be the most intense place. And the help is also off the charts. So you can't factor, you know, you have to get out of your mind. Go out of your mind, actually. And just go on faith. Just go for it, is my advice now at this point in time. Just commit to the Holy Spirit. Just commit. And we'll see how it goes. It's a wonderful time. Because it's either that or you're just going to go insane, you know? Really. You might as well go out of your mind rather than going insane. Going insane is getting too much into your mind, so to speak. You know, I'm just using words here. You're gonna get boxed into your thoughts and thinking, and that sort of mind, which isn't really mind at all. It's pretending to not be mind. And you're gonna go insane. And you're gonna medicate and you're just gonna, you know, you're gonna turn into a zombie. So you might as well go out of your mind. So I was out of my mind, still am to some extent out of my mind. I'm functioning fine, everything's fine. But I'll never be the same. Once you realize you can flip the perspective to this extent, it's like, hey, it's like my fear of Jesus disappeared. Like hanging out, or just, it was like, I've done it, I've already done it. And, you know, the ramifications I don't even want to think about. So, I really haven't been thinking about them. This is the full stop in the way. You don't think about the ramifications. You don't try to chase them down. You just let them go and you say, I'll meet up with them soon enough. It's just this enormous kaboom. And you say, okay, you know, let the dust settle, and then we'll see how the landscape looks. So, you know, I didn't see this coming, really. I've never read anything like this. But I've been very jittery for since, you know, April, for about a week or so. Just super intense. And then this happens, and I say, oh, wow, of course, wow, wow. That one's not even been written about. I can see why. Oh my gosh, it's been alluded to a little bit, but not as clearly as seeing it this way. It's just, so you can't even imagine what are the ramifications. You know, don't even try to chase them down. You just say, consciously say, no, okay, let it, they'll come. And people are like being suddenly super nice to me. I don't know how to explain it. It's the Holy Spirit. So you don't know what's around the corner. That's why I say put your faith in, put your trust in faith at this point. Don't try to think your way through it. It doesn't work anymore. There could be a flipping of the script happen tomorrow or tonight that just You're just going to sit there and just say, wow, I never ever even thought I could consider that. I mean, that just completely changes everything. This is just a total game changer. You know, this could happen like that, actually. We're into that intensity now. So we say, yeah. But you know, it's fine. It's just, it's just, you just, you practice full stop and the wow, you got it. You guess not, it's no trouble. It's no trouble. You just do it. You just say, okay, I just practice this now and this is the way I'm going to be and go through the day. Now, is it a strain? Yes. But this is the time when the strain is okay. I have terrible strain. I woke up 4 in the morning again. I'm hardly sleeping at all. 2 in the morning, I wake up 4. I had to practice. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I had to practice that for hours this morning just to try and calm down. Because the flipping of the script now that's happening here, it's just off the charts. It's almost like uncharted territory. I have to calm down. It's like, wow. But I also was just having great laughter, just roaring with laughter. It is so funny what we're trying to do. When you see the absurdity, it is so hilarious. The utter absurdity of the egoic belief system. When you see it, it's just too funny. It's like someone counterfeiting money and they're super angry because someone else is counterfeiting their counterfeit money, their fakeness, their faking fakeness. Hey, how dare you fake fakeness? My fakeness is the real fakeness and you're trying to fake fakeness. The whole squabble's over fake fakeness and who's, you know, I got the real fakeness. It's hilarious. Absolutely hilarious what our mind is trying to do. It's just silly nonsense, actually. Arguing over, you know, I got the real fakeness here. And then just say, look at this. Oh, wait a minute. I'm just catching this stuff. I say, whoa, wait a minute. Just look at this. That's insane. And you see the insanity of what we've been caught in. And that's all we've just been, you just see it, you just laugh. That's all you do is just laugh. And then that's it. Just have a good laugh. That's the reaction. That's the reaction. It's just, oh my God, that's really funny. I've never had any lives at all. All these fake lives, those aren't lives. Fake death, fake lives, there's no lives there. These lives are completely fake. Completely fake. Hey, so the more you see this, the more the ramifications just like, I don't try to chase them down. This is the discipline of the wow. And it takes confidence and takes faith. Otherwise you think, oh, this may be my only chance. I've got to try to grasp, you know, and this is the mistake we make. Okay. You got to have confidence and trust in the Holy Spirit and the path and just say, you know what? It'll come. All this ramifications will come to me eventually. And so I just stay loose and relaxed and confident and say, okay, I'm not going to even try to grab anything. Whatever's worth coming will just come to me naturally, and I'll see it, and I'll just say, oh yeah, okay, no problem. Don't struggle. Just say, I got this. There's no question, oh, I got this. The ego's totally finished, no question about it. I'm a total world beater. Just say that. I absolutely am the world beater here, period. I've absolutely got this. I'm completely unstoppable. Absolutely unstoppable. Nothing can ruin my life whatsoever. You know, you need to say these things to yourself. My life will never be ruined. It's impossible to ruin my life. Nothing can ruin my life. I'm completely unstoppable. Say these things to yourself. I'm completely unstoppable. Nothing can ruin my life. I'm totally blessed. I'm totally blessed. So try saying these affirmations. In other words, have ultimate confidence in yourself. The ego is completely finished. Doesn't even have the slightest prayer of a chance of ever stopping me. None. Zero. And that's a fact. That's an absolute fact. Assert this. You see, these are assertions. Just do this. Just do these assertions. What do you have to lose right now? Right? What do you have to lose? It's either this or get boxed into a nightmare. So you say, I've already won, you know, I've won. That's it. Game's already over. Game's already over. I'm just getting used to this fact, but it's over. Totally over. It's over with. So that's what this is my dialogue that I have here. I'm not sitting schlepping along saying, you know, oh, what do I do? I'm so true. I don't know. Can I do? That's not what's going on in my dialogue anymore. I'm saying, wow. I've completely won. There's no question about it that liberation is mine, and I am absolutely free. Total success. Ego doesn't have a prayer, not even a prayer, of ever coming back on me in the slightest bit. There's nothing that can ever bother me or ruin my life. Nothing can ruin my life. It's totally impossible for my life to be ruined. This is how I talk to myself. So you can do it. There's nothing saying you can't do it. There's not any law that says you can't do this. And I said, why not? Why not? Why not do that? Was the thought police going to come get you? No. Now, it's true, it's a little difficult to sleep. I recommend drinking tart red cherry juice before you go to bed. That helps. Someone told me that today. He said, hey, you got to, you know, you realize this is super good to helping you sleep. And I'm gonna try it before bedtime, because I'm just so buzzed out on success. It's just, you know, it's tough to sleep. But that's okay. It's okay, because this is the time where it's okay to be stressed out. You see, just tell yourself, it's okay to be stressed out right now. In fact, that's a good sign. It's a great sign. That means that your success is off the charts. And you're a winner, you see. It's stressful to be a winner at first, but then you get used to it. I can smell the orange blossoms, the citrus blossoms on the breeze here. Wow. You just say, I'm totally unstoppable now. I am absolutely, totally unstoppable. And leave it abstract. Don't try to attach it to anything. Because as soon as you attach it to something, then there's a concept of stoppability. No, I'm beyond that. I'm just unstoppable, period. You see? You leave it that way. And then just feel, how does that feel? Now, at first, it feels like stressful, like shockwaves. Okay, then just enjoy the shockwaves. This dream, it can't hold me. You know, there's no way it can hold me now. There's no way. It's impossible. It's a fait accompli. Just keep giving yourself these ultimate pep talks, you know, these ultimate statements. Because it's true. if you accept this for yourself, it's true, because this is really the truth. The dream cannot hold us at all. And if we're willing to accept this, then most certainly the script will flip for us. And we'll see. We'll see. We'll see it the way it is. But don't force the seeing. When the seeing comes, accept it. And then tell yourself, wow, that's it. I mean, I'm a winner. Total winner. Instead of saying, that I really have that, you know, that I really see that, and what does it mean, and how effective will it be, and all, that's all nonsense. Don't engage, refuse to engage in that. The full stop in the wow, you do not engage in that. You can just say, that's it, wow, wow, that's it. I'm totally blessed. You see, I'm totally blessed. So just feel how that feels. I'm inexpressibly blessed. I'm in effervescent. I'm completely in effervescent, ineffable and evanescent. I'm completely in effervescent. I'm absolutely, I am just living in, I am just abiding in this pure blessing. Now, I saw how it was applied to the basic conundrum, but I don't want to mentally try to get back to that right now. I just have faith. I saw it. It's finished. It's finished. That's it. Knockout. Yeah, I know I landed the knockout blow, actually, today. And so, I'm not, it's already done. It's finished. So there's nothing more to think about. You know, think about, okay, you know, how did I do it? You know, am I really? No, I just have faith. I saw it. I saw it very clearly. Oh, okay, that just knocks that out entirely. That was the obstacle to abidance. It's just knocked out now. Landed the knockout blow. Okay, full stop on the wow. And just have faith. Let the river just you know, you're on a river. The river's carrying you to the sea. So just enjoy the ride. Don't try to push the river. It's taking you fast. You'll get there. Have this total confidence in the grace of God. Have total confidence in it. The more confidence you have in it, the better it goes for you. And you just assert it, because it's true. All you're doing is standing up for yourself. That's all. For truth. For what you really are. You're not a body at all. No one's a body. Just stand up for that fact. We've never been a body. How does making something counterfeit mean it's real? It's not. It's counterfeit. These bodies are just counterfeit, imaginary, ridiculous. Jesus calls them just stick figures. They don't have anything to do with what we are. This world has nothing to do with what we are, actually. It's totally counterfeit, fake. What we are, our true life can't be ruined at all. It's impossible. It's totally impossible. So all these Silicon Valley techistas, techies and techistas, or do we say techas? I don't know, techies and techas. They think they're living intensely. Well, they should step into my shoes. they step into my shoes and see what kind of intensity is there. It makes the Silicon Valley look like it's in a coma. So just take it in stride. See, I expect it. I expect success. So when it comes, you're not surprised. So I expect it. Okay, great. I am a world beater, absolutely. I am an awakener. The dream cannot hold me. Cannot hold me. However you want to say it. I am a total success. I am absolutely successful. Absolutely successful. And you say, I just know it. I know it, so I don't need to think about it. I know it. There's no question about it. So there's no reason to doubt it or think about it or elaborate upon it. It's very cut and dried. It's very cut and dried. Completely obvious. It's completely obvious I'm awakened. I'm awake. It's completely obvious I'm awake. Try that one. That's a powerful one. It's totally evident that I'm awake, that I'm free. It's totally evident that I'm free, and I'm no longer bothered. It's totally evident that I'm at peace. It's totally evident that I'm in bliss. It's totally evident that I'm at peace. Totally evident I'm in bliss. It's totally evident that I'm untroubled, entirely untroubled. It's totally evident that I'm entirely untroubled. It's totally evident that nothing can touch me, nothing can bother me, nothing can ruin me. Completely evident, here's someone, that nothing can ruin them. There's nothing that can ruin them whatsoever. It's impossible. Tomorrow, I think it's supposed to be 95 here or something. I mean, it's just, wow. I'm sweating. It's like, what? I said it's going to be a long, hot summer. The hottest in history, baby. Well, yeah, way hotter than normal. Probably. But it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. The world has been entirely overcome here. There's no more trouble at all. Trouble doesn't exist. Nothing can trouble me. Just say this. There's nothing at all that can ever trouble me ever again. I can never be troubled ever again. I didn't find God. I am God. You see, this is the key. This is what the teachers tell us. You don't ever find God. You realize it. You realize just that I am God. Because there's only God. There's a trinity to it, but it's still all God. So I am God. Never, no one's ever found God. No one ever will find God. What is there that could find God? There's only God being God. There's nothing other than that to find God. God is not in some place. God is everywhere. Everywhere is not a place. It's absurd to speak of everywhere as some place. Completely absurd. Completely dualistic. Dualism is absurdity, actually. Everywhere is not a place. There's no place. You say, "Well, yeah, I'm in this place." No, I'm in everywhereness. I am everywhereness. There's no I am in it because there's no out of it. So, it's beyond speech, isn't it? Reality is fundamentally beyond speech and words. Because words imply their opposite. Say, well, I'm abiding in it. Well, that implies that it's possible to not abide in it, which is not true. It's not true. So, to speak out of it all requires a repentant mind that does not assume the dualistic inference at all. It doesn't assume a dualistic inference. It's entirely possible to assume it if you're not repentant. You can confound yourself easily listening to words. So it takes a great deal of willingness to listen to words without feeling like, well, wait a minute, did it mean this or that? No, it's just, if you say, well, I'm abiding in it, they say, well, then what about non-abiding? So ultimately, there's nothing that can be said in words that ultimately is it, because words are dependent on the listener granting, saying, okay, I'm not going to assume an inference from this, of an opposite to this. But the potential, is there for mischief if they want to assume. But what about non-abidance then? So, it's just God is. There's no possibility of anything, of non-isness or anything like that. Ineffable evanescence. It's just ineffable. A label is always subject to interpretation or something, right? But there's no interpretation of allness. What kind of interpretation could there be of allness? It's meaningless. There's no interpretation of reality. And symbols are arbitrary, really. How can freedom have a symbol? It's absurd, isn't it? Totally absurd. So when you start to see this absurdity, all you can do is laugh. It's so silly. A label to pure freedom? A label? Really? Faking it? Faking pure freedom? What? What is that? What are you faking? That's ridiculous, isn't it? As opposed to what? Non-faking? Have you got faking? No, pure freedom doesn't have an opposite. What could you be opposing? Freedom, but freedom it can't be defined. See, I'm opposing freedom. Freedom is not a word. It's literally your functionality, our power. That we cannot be trapped, ever in any specific. So how can we have a say there's a specific opposition to it? You know, all we could say is just nothing. I mean, a symbol, a meaning, you know, meaningless. We just have to infer some meaning to it, but there isn't any. What is freedom? Is it this? Is it this experience? That experience? No, it's not any particular experience at all. It's impossible to reflect it in any way. We cannot reflect it. So, how can there be some opposite to freedom, actually? Stuck somewhere? Well, how can you say that's an opposite to freedom? You're having some experience, you claim that that's an opposite? Freedom doesn't have any specific experience that you could say that's freedom. And if nothing is definitional of freedom, no experience is any more definitional than any other. It's zero. No experience is more definitional of freedom than any other. They're all experiences are equally zero definitional, defining of freedom. No quality of definition whatsoever, ever. And the citrus blossoms are getting even more intense. It's just like the whole air is just saturated. Wow. Very, very nice. I guess this hot weather just kicked them into high gear. There isn't any appearance that is the slightest bit definitional nor non-definitional. Because non-definitional is implying that there could be something that is more definitional than this. In other words, it's not like, well, this is very non-definitional. It's not even that. It's beyond, you know, even any possibility of conceptually structuring and is it saying anything about it, right? Really. So everything is just equally zero in terms of defining freedom. It's all zero. As soon as we start playing the game, well, this is less definitional, or this is like really non-definitional. We start going a slippery slope. Well, okay, well maybe there's something that is a little better than non-definitional. No. It's better to say just it no matter what arises, it's all exactly, you know, the same in terms of zero indication of freedom, what we are. No indication. And in the same hand, you know, total indication in the fact that it's no indication, that is the total indication, that no indication whatsoever is the indication of freedom. But that's still subtly conceptual. We understand that because we're using words. There's no way to get around being subtly conceptual, right? There's still some subtle feel of structure in using words. Otherwise, what would words mean at all, right? And there's no structure to freedom. It is completely unbounded, completely without any structure whatsoever. How could perfect freedom have structure? That you need to experience this and then this and that. There's some sequence to it. There's no sequence to it. There's every sequence to it, actually. It's all sequences. all possible sequences right now. Like Ramana Maharshi's saying, I'm saying everything. That's sequence, right? He's saying, really, this is the presence of all sequence. Continuously, every moment, the allness of all possible sequences, infinitely, endlessly, eternally, is always present. You could call it potentiality too, right? You could call it bliss too, bliss, right? Calmness, peace of mind. This is what the mind's natural state is not without any sequence, but with all possible sequences, always present. That's great. Ramana said silence isn't the absence of thoughts or it's our speech or anything. It's everything. Without leaving anything out whatsoever. This is the natural state of the mind. So this is just like becoming apparent and easy, you know, for me to look at this. Now, pragmatically, I have to say that in the intensity of the times and the severity of the times and the hardening of the attitudes and people going absolutely crazy, getting just completely caught up in outsmarting themselves and this, all this is, that maybe some will not come to this realization of allness. Maybe some will get free, and others will say, well, how did you do that? And I just say, they'll say, I just can't, I don't know, I don't think I can get there right now. Okay, well, that could very well happen. And so we just cross that bridge and we get to it. That too is just a sequence out of infinite possibility sequences. Everything is just, they're just sequences out of the ocean of all sequences. But we're perfectly free to choose another sequence any instant. You know, there's literally infinite sequences, isn't there? From any point, from the now, right now, there's literally an infinitude. This very instant of sequences, right? We can do this and then that and or that, you know, this over here and then that and this. There's no end to the sequences that we could choose. It's never ending. It's never ending because every moment we're free. I'm sorry, I'm just doing a full stop on the wow here. I just, keeping my poise here. This is just, it's just rocking me, just absolutely rocking me. In the right way. There's no sequence that defines what we are at all. And again, not even to the slightest bit. That's how we can abide in the now then. I'm always in the now. See, I am always in the now, inherently. I'm always at the total alpha and omega point, both simultaneously, always right there and now. Everything starts with me and everything ends with me. Every instant. I never leave that being the beginning and the end. Every step I take is both a beginning and an ending. Both. So this day was made for spiritual buzz today. It most certainly was. I don't know. I don't know how others will be affected. I don't know. We'll just have to cross that bridge when we get to it. People may, I don't know, people may just start to sequence things just like they just want to just sit there. You know, we don't know exactly how it will play out, but there's all sorts of possibilities. Really, there's infinite actually. There may be people who just, I mean, going living through the '60s, I can tell you that all of that is possible too, isn't it? People just get a serape and just sit somewhere underneath that serape and just sit there. That's it. Maybe they didn't feel like moving or going anywhere. They just would sit there for days, or people just hang out somewhere. They just sit, just sitting. Some people will start dancing, and they just dance all the time. Some people just walk. We're just walking. It's going to come to that and more, really. I mean, a total freak out is coming, or a total out of your mindness is coming. And some will just start doing it, and other people just start doing it. You know, maybe some will just sit down on a sidewalk, and then you'll see people everywhere just sitting down on sidewalks. And that's it. Not even going to work anymore. I'm not kidding. I'm not kidding. It's just one day someone will do in a suit, three-piece suit, the briefcase will just put their briefcase down on the sidewalk and take their coat off or something and just sit down against a lamppost or something and just sit there all day. And other people will see that, and suddenly they'll start doing it too. And before you know it, people just aren't going to work anymore. And they won't offer any explanation or anything. They just, this is what I'm doing now. Don't bet against it. Again, I lived through the heart of the 60s, right in the heart of where it all happened. And this is what happened. You get, you know, PhD students and candidates and professors and stuff. They just, one day, they just go down, you know, the Big Sur coast, and they're just sitting there, and they don't come back. And they might come back after a few weeks or something, and just, you know, what happened? You know, you've got this 10-year job. You get to, and no explanation. And then, you know, I'll see you later, and just wander off, and that's it. People, these corporate people, they have these corporate jobs, they just one day they just don't show up anymore. That's what happened. And then more and more and more and more people, that's what happened. Really, really, I kid you not. And what happened to them? Well, they're like, they're out somewhere on some farm or in the woods or something, and they're just hanging out, just sitting somewhere, or just walking around, just walking. And they hang out with other people that do that, and they kind of look at each other and they say, yeah, I get it. No one else gets it, but, you know, the ones they're hanging out with, they all get it, because they're doing the same thing. It's just like, poof, they just changed their sequencing. They just changed it. Now, that's not enlightenment, okay? We're not saying they're enlightened or anything, no. Enlightenment is just abidance in the now of the Alpha and Omega of all sequences. And realizing I never leave the now at all. It's impossible to. That's Ramana Maharshi, for instance. These people are you know, the 60s did not give rise to all these enlightened beings. So let's be clear about this. It did not. This was more of just like they just had to change the sequence. But they still are in another sequence. They think, you know, they're still thinking they're in this now they've shifted their sequence. So, you know, you, if you're on the spiritual path, you got to be careful about this. This is why I say get into the court of a Dharma king. Our queen. So you do not just freak out, as they said back in the 60s. Just you get this corporate square person going to work every day, and then suddenly they just suddenly don't show up anymore. If they find him 6 months later, you know, lived in some cabin in the woods, and they got long hair and a beard, and they're in, you know, dressed in raggedy clothing, and they're semi-starving, and they're just, there's no explanation. They say, I don't even know you. I mean, I just completely drop out, as you know, the turn on, tune in, and drop out, as it was the mantra of the 60s, Timothy Leary. Literally, that's what happened. People just went from one extreme to the other. Because what they're really saying, I just can't handle the sequencing. I just can't handle. But what happens is the hippies thing is a sequencing also. And people thought, well, the hippies are free. No, they're not really free. It's just another corporate thing. It's just they're corporate hippies now. They're part of the hippie corporation. And they're now running things. The hippie corporation is now going to turn into the yoga girl communism, which is going to be running things. But people will drop out of that, too. And you might be one of those who just drop out, you know, right? But keep in mind, these videos, hopefully they'll help you at some point realizing, hey, wait a minute, this isn't it either. Out of the frying pan, into the fire. A fool learns from their own mistakes. A wise being learns from the mistake of others, meaning learning from the mistakes of history. So I'm reporting like from the past, from the 60s, you know, I'm a great resource because I lived it, and I was very aware of everything. And we don't want to repeat the mistakes there. Those who don't learn from the mistakes of the past are doomed to repeat them. So, what you do is full stop on the wow and keep going for enlightenment. And you can keep working, you can keep functioning. Ramaharshi said you must find your, you know, do your spiritual practice and find enlightenment right within the midst of the turmoil of your life. That's what he said. You must do it. You must do it that way. And the key to success, there is a secret to success, and it's everyday practice. That is the key. There is no other key. That is the key. All right? So for me, I never got entirely dragged into the hippie thing. I never did. You know, I just sort of like was on the fringes of it all because I was like still too, you know, still very disciplined and determined to be enlightened. I said, this is my destiny. And I said, I don't think that this hippie thing is going to lead me to that destiny. But I didn't want to be seen as like a square, you know, I either. So I was kind of in the middle of it all. And you know, nobody knew really what to make of me, really. I didn't really fit in anywhere. Still don't. Because I would say, wait a minute, let's really look at this. What's really going on? What's being said? Let us dig deeper into this. But no, the hippies were just sequencing their new sequence of what they thought was no sequence. But again, enlightenment is not a question of no sequence. It's a question of you realize you are all sequence right now. There's no sequence withheld from you at all. Absolute freedom. So that's not just like I'm doing a new sequence. That's not it at all. So the hippies use a lot of drugs to try to bust out of the old sequence, the old corporate sequence, and find a new sequence. And now they've become, you know, the corporation that we're trying to get free of now. That's what happened. The progressive liberals, communists, let's be honest, seriously. Take it from me who you know lived through the communist, the Cold War, communism, understanding, you know, what it's really about. We're facing communism. That's what we're facing. Period. You know, disguise, put a dress on it, it's still communism. Don't fool yourself. And this is what it's turned into. Is the hippies now think that they know what's best for everybody? Said our sequence is best, and they're like complete. They're like more rigid than the military industrial complex corporatists before. Seriously, they really are. This is the truth, honest to God. I mean, I remember the military industrial corporate people, and you know what? They were pretty weird. Their sequencing was pretty weird. Okay, yes. But they weren't nearly as militant, as extremist, as fanatical, as self-righteous as these, you know, hip corporation hippie. Progressive, radical progressives, Marxists, Leninists, socialists, communists. Those are the ones that are certain. They're saying that our sequence, we found the right sequencing for you. Now, what could be further away from enlightenment than saying we found the right sequence for you? That's the antithesis of enlightenment. But they say, no, we took all the drugs, we lived through this, we found our freedom, and now we're here to tell you that this is liberation, this is freedom. You know, it's the antithesis of it. Meet the new boss, same as the old boss. You know who the cool people are right now in the United States? Hispanics. Because they're just trying to get along and survive. And they just want to say, how can I be helpful to you? And how can I be friendly to you? You know, and it's just like, wow. They don't have this self-righteousness, that we know the right sequence for you. They don't have it. They just saying, you know, am I sequencing it okay for you? And they're so nice, you know, Hispanics. They're so pleasant. They're not on some ego trip. And they just look at you, you know, they look at you and in the eye, they talk with you, and they're saying, you know, I'm just trying to get along, that's all. Now, will that last? It never lasts, okay? It never lasts. Here, there's the dynamic of this egoic sacrificial belief system. It just keeps cycling. But right now, I come across all these Hispanics all day long, and they're all really good people. I can just open a window and say, hey, is this the, you know, ask a Hispanic question? They always look at me. They always answer me. They always try to be helpful. They're always friendly. They're not on power trips. They're not on ego trips. They're not. So it's like very refreshing, very refreshing. Just very down to earth, and they're just saying, they're really saying is, well, I'm not really sure what sequence is right, so I'm just, you know, doing the best I can, that's all, because they're new here, then they're not really sure, you know, what's going on. I mean, how could they, you know, they're pretty newly arrived here, and they don't know the 60s and the Cold War and everything. A lot of them are younger, they don't understand what's really going on at the higher echelons, you know, of the power structure of the United States at all. They don't at all. They kind of ask me questions like, you know, they don't have a clue. They're just working. They just want to get a job and work and make some money and survive. That's it. And they're so cooperative. It's just amazing. And you don't feel bad about asking them, could you help me with this? And do they ever say no? No, they never say no. They help you. They're helpful. Do they ever cop some attitude? I've never experienced it. I could just come up to them and say, you know, if you got a moment, could you help me with this? And they'd say, okay, yeah, as soon as I finish it, sure. And there's no attitude at all. It's amazing. It's a blessing. I don't know what we do without this attitude in the United States right now. Now they don't treat you like they're some slave or anything. They just relate to you like you're a person, but there's respect, you know. They treat you like, you know, they assume that you're a good person, and if you need some help, of course they're going to help out. They don't have this, you know, attitude. They don't have an attitude, really. It's just like, so this is what's keeping the country functioning, actually, right now, tell you the truth. I can walk on any job site anywhere in the country, construction site, and you know what? I won't feel hostility or weirdness. And if I want to talk to some Hispanic, you know, they're going to talk with me and they'll listen to what I say and they'll respond intelligently. And there's no trouble. There's no vibe. You know, it's amazing. Take that away, take all that away, and the countries will be at each other's throats. They're not really trying to choose sides. They're just trying to do an honest day's work, is what they're trying to do. And they work really hard. And they don't complain. It's amazing. I look at it and say, man, that's a tough job you're doing. They say, hey, I got to do it, man. You know, do I have a choice? That's what they tell me. I say, man, I'm sorry. I mean, that's just brutal what you're doing. And they just look at me and they just say, hey, do I have a choice? And I kind of say, well, yeah, I mean, but I don't. They just, hey, I don't have any choice, man. This is what I do. I break rocks all day in the hot sun. You know, I got the jackhammer. I'm just jackhammering concrete all day. And, you know, they walk off the job and they're just happy to be jackhammering concrete all day. And they don't like look at you like, yeah, you got a better job than me. Yeah, you're more fortunate than me. No, no. They understand. They understand. You know that. You know they're just happy to have work. And it's just amazing, just amazing. So we better not be too quick to condemn the situation, because without that attitude, I don't know how I could function. I don't know how anyone could function. It's just the entitlement complexes and the sequencing of we're right, you know, among so many now. It's just impossible, isn't it? It's just impossible. We can't talk. We can't relate with one another anymore. But a lot of the Hispanics are just apolitical. They don't know anything about our political system. They don't even have an opinion. They don't have opinions about all these social topics that we're all freaked out about. Like, how do we sequence this? They don't even have an opinion. And it's so nice to just hang out with them. And you know, it's easy to talk with them. Because they just notice stuff just straight out. They just notice, you know, they're not all contaminated with self-righteousness. They really are not. They're just trying to survive. They're just focused on survival is what they're focused on. Now again that once that they are able to survive, then they look for better jobs and then they start getting an attitude. Of course that's what happens. There's no question about it. But I can tell you, you know, I don't know if I've ever had a bad experience with a Hispanic. I really don't. Even the ones that are kind of tough and harsh, you know, you just kind of stand your ground and you say that, you know, and then they soften up. They soften up and everything's fine, you know. They're just, hey, I'm just happy that I got some food. That's it. I got a house, got some food, and, you know, hey. And I say, really, you know, we're all just, also, it's just the same, right? I mean, pretty amazing what's going on. They're putting into Social Security. You're not going to get anything out of it. They're keeping the country afloat. I mean, how do we? They're pumping so much money into taxes, Social Security, all this stuff, and they're never going to see a penny of it. It's like indentured servitude. But they're not really complaining. They don't complain. Well, the demagogues will get them going, you know, at some point. Gradually, you know, they'll start protesting, and the rot will set in at some point. But, you know, we're still in this time where, you know, the attitude is, you know, is exemplary attitude. Humble attitude. They're not saying, hey, my sequencing is right. They might say, yeah, I like my sequencing. I say, well, yeah, that's good. I like mine too. They say, yeah, that's good too. And there's not this conflict of thinking, you know, power trip. There's just not a power trip at this point, which is very, very refreshing. It actually helps with enlightenment. You can't get into enlightenment when you're power tripping with some sequence. Hippie Incorporated, you know, is just runs the country right now. Radical Incorporated. And they are just power tripping like nobody's ever power tripped before, ego tripping, like no one's ever ego tripped before. They're absolutely wretched. It's the yoga girl syndrome. You know, I know the right sequence. Look at me. Look how, you know, poised and beautiful. Obviously, I have the right sequence. That's the yoga girl attitude. Obviously, I have the right sequence. I have this right spiritual sequence. Well, that's the antithesis of spiritual truth. It's the antithesis of it. Okay. It's exactly that which we need to see through. That's exactly what we need to be liberated from, is any notion that that there's some right sequence in pure freedom. There can't be. It's all sequence, and I'm both the beginning and the end right now of everything. I never move out of that. So there's no self-righteousness in any sequence at all. So the yoga girl communist, it means we got the right sequence. This is what's the power structure now of the world. This is what's coming. And it's awful. We thought the military industrial complex was bad. Wait till you see, get a load of this. You could criticize those people. Yeah, we did. Back in the 60s, I mean, we rebelled against all this authority, and you know what? They took it pretty well. They took it a heck of a lot better than the yoga girls are going to take any rebellion against their right self-righteous ego tripping. They're not going to put up with any criticism of it. I can tell you that. I mean, they're real headbusters. That's what's coming. So people will just, you know, drop out and get their heads busted, probably. I don't know exactly how it'll play out, but people will just suddenly drop out. That's it. You had people in the 60s working for, you know, some military industrial complex corporation, you know, and they've got the wife and four kids, and one day they come home from work just like every other day, and they've got a backpack with them, and they pack up some stuff in their backpack. They get in the car and they say to the wife and kids, I'm taking off. And bye, goodbye. And they drive off like that, never return. And or maybe just take the pack and walk off, walk away from the house, leave the car. Where are you going? I don't know. And just start hitchhiking, and they end up hitchhiking for the next 10 years, and who knows where they go. They just, that's it. They just completely decide, boom, like a switch, and they just drop out and just leave their wife, children, home, everything, and just poof, go. And my dad did that. He just left. He just left. He said, I just can't take it anymore. And, we didn't even know where he went. He spent the rest of his life wandering around all over the world. I didn't see him for what, 30 years or so. No, like 20, 22 years or something. I didn't even see him. Didn't even see him. He's just gone. Wandering in India somewhere. I don't know. Japan, whatever. He's all over the planet. Just. He just completely dropped out of the whole cultural thing, you know? Stopped working. He had some sort of pension from Social Security, or I mean, there's teaching or something. He was getting something enough to, but he relied on friends around the world to get some money to travel the next place, and that's all he did the rest of his life was just travel from place to place. And I don't even, we don't even know what he did, actually. Yeah, that's literally what happened. Kind of a shock. Well, it was a good thing ultimately because he was so frustrated. It was just not good. He didn't like the sequencing, so he kept trying to find some new sequencing, and it didn't work. Ultimately, he said, I didn't find it. I didn't find it. So you have to look within. But they're still looking for a sequence. This is still has not cut through. Has not cut through the knot of absurdity. So this is coming, in one way or another. You can feel it coming, can't you? That the people are simply going to flip a switch at some point. You don't see it coming. Literally, you come up one day, they just they said, that's it. I, and this is my new sequence. It's tough to take. It's really tough to take. You might have a housewife, long hair, and she goes to the beauty parlor and dressed this way. And one day she come home and she's shaved all her hair off, and she's dressed completely differently. And she says, goodbye. That's it. And just completely flip the persona, the sequencing, just totally different, on a totally different tangent. Now they think this is enlightenment. They often use drugs to get to this. It's not. It doesn't have anything to do with enlightenment, actually. Nothing to do with it. A lot. All this rhetoric of the '60s was just a side trip. It was a red herring. It had nothing to do with enlightenment. It really didn't. Timothy Leary had nothing to do with enlightenment, actually. That's the truth. These gurus of the '60s and '70s, no, they really did not have anything to do with enlightenment at all. In fact, it was misleading, very misleading, which is why it was so confusing, because they all thought they had found it. No, they just found some other sequence that was contrasting different than their other one. But look at them now. Now they're the millionaires, okay? All these rich, wealthy people, they're a lot of them were the dropouts and the hippies that, they became, now they're the millionaires with their homes all over the world, and they think they know what's right for us. They found it. They think, yeah, I found it. I dropped out of that, and now I've found it, and we're going to set things right. Wow. And they'd go to these gurus and stuff, and maybe genuine ones, and they say, "Hey, you know, I'm free, I'm founded." And the gurus say, no, you don't get it." And say, "What do you mean? You know, look what I did." You know, and they'd have some attitude, like, you know, "Hey, I've got it." The gurus say, "No, you haven't even started the path. What are you talking about?" And it's true what they're saying. They haven't started the path. They're just avoiding it. So, a lot of, there's an inundation. You got to be careful of that. You know, there's inundation. You might, if you go along with them, you could be a fake guru. It's, "Oh yeah, all these people here, all these going to be, they found it." You know, no, they just have gotten onto some other sequence. They haven't found it at all. There's nothing to find, actually. I'm always the Alpha and the Omega and everything else. There's nothing to find. And you get pulled into that trap because they want a figurehead. They want a figurehead that will tell them that they've found it. So the fake gurus abound in those times. There's so many false teachers and gurus that seem to be great teachers and everything, but no, they weren't enlightened. They just saw an opportunity, they're opportunists, and said, "Wow, if I just tell all these people they found it, then they'll treat me like I'm some, you know, king, a guru and everything, and I'll have all these, you know, palaces and homes and Rolls Royces and everything else, and yeah, just live the high life." It was easy for them if they're willing to do that. If they're cynical enough, you know, to exploit it like that, then of course there always are some that are that cynical. That they just told all the hippies that they found it. And that they're right there, you know. You just got to do a little tweaking, and then they say, "Well, I'll help you do a little tweaking, you know, and then you'll get it just right, a little tune up here." And the hippies, "Oh yeah, great," you know, that's what they wanted to hear. But the real teachers told them, "Look, you're no different than, you know, some engineer at NASA or something. You know, you're no different at all. There's no difference at all. Same." The hippies would say, "What? You know, you crazy? You know, what's the matter with you?" So the real gurus had all these real strict rules and regulations, so the hippies just couldn't handle it. They didn't want to be bothered. And some, like Punjaji, got inundated by him, and he basically said, "Hey, you're all enlightened, you know, get out of here." Because they're telling me, "No, boy, I can look at this sequence. I got this enlightened sequence." And he's just like, "Oh man, you know, this is too much." And, okay. He said, "Okay, yeah, whatever. You're enlightened. Go do your thing now. Whatever." that's something like that's what they say. That he said, "I just did it to get the leeches off my back." You know, I mean, they're just like looking for this, you know, enlightenment figure that would affirm that they're enlightened, that they got it. You know. But generally, a lot of the real teachers, they have this situation where it's very difficult to, you know, get into, follow the rules and this and this and that, because they want to protect themselves from being inundated by all this nonsense. They're looking for real, those who are truly serious. So we may be going into the biggest freak out in history, right, coming up. And so, you know, don't get caught in either one. Don't get caught of the one that says, "I've got it," or the one that says, "Oh yeah, you've got it." You know, that's the dualistic trap there. It's better to just go play golf. You know, don't get caught in that at all. Thinking that, you know, you can tell people they've got it, and then everybody will think that you're some master. You know, that you're enlightened. This is a very dangerous trap. You might get all, you might, I mean, the tech women might suddenly turn into Barbie dolls, you know? Really, the feminists are, I mean, these women are so aggressive now. They're more aggressive than the men, and at some point they may just freak out and just turn into these love goddess Barbie dolls or something, and it's just like, and they're looking for some guru to affirm that they've got it. Dangerous trap, that is for sure. And just go play golf, say, I don't know what you're talking about. Well, I'm nobody's guru, and nobody's guru. Yeah, I mean, just astonishing what could happen. They could just suddenly flip out into some total glam trip. Seriously, there's going to be so much flipping out coming up. It's just you can't. I can't even hardly imagine. But it's like the '60s amplified to a large extent, probably. A lot of these women have made so much money now. It's incredible how much money they're just buying houses. They're just absolutely techies. Oh my gosh! And at some point, they may just suddenly decide, just flip out. And just become utter hippies, and live off the money that they have, and just turn into prostitutes or something. Really, seriously. They may literally do that. Just not because they need the money at all. I mean, you just can't even, we don't even know what the freak out is coming in this world, really. We're right at the breaking point. You can feel it, psychological breaking point. And the whole, the other game, musical chairs, when your kids and everybody goes around and the music stops, you got to find a chair. It's kind of like that. There's this tune playing, everybody's moving around. Suddenly the music stops and everybody scrambles for a chair. Well, it's a different chair, right? It's a different chair. And you just have these complete personality shifts taking place. So, for me, I just want to go play golf, basically. I don't want to be involved in that at all. That's a quagmire. It's a quagmire. These personality shifts have nothing to do with enlightenment. It does not show anything at all that somebody is conformed to the spiritual path. This is the devastating mistake that happened in the six start in the '60s. It was just. And we wondered what happened, what happened, what happened, So you just want to distance yourself from all this stuff, yeah. Pretty amazing, huh? It's coming very soon. How did the '60s happen? Well, it happened pretty darn fast, actually. Cold War really pushed it. It really pushed it. We just couldn't take it anymore. We couldn't take waking up in the morning and feeling like they were going, the atomic bomb was going to be dropped on our heads. That's how we felt every single moment of the day. And we just said, this is, we just, there's something wrong with this. We just can't handle it anymore. And we wanted it to end. The Cold War wanted it to end. And then we wanted the Vietnam War to end. And so we just decided, for me, I'm just opting out of this whole thing as if that would somehow end it. And ultimately, it did have something to do with ending it. Well, it's come back, but they just said, I can't be part of any of this anymore. I just can't play this game. I'm finished with this game. I quit. I quit the game, hoping that that would, calm their nerves. I just quit the game. I quit the game. So don't be surprised if this happens here in a massive way. It's just, I quit this game. Well, they take up some other game. But at first, it seems like this, oh, I got this new game. And wow, and then the yoga girl communists are hell bent on telling the world, getting the world to accept that their sequencing is the right one, and thinking that will then make them happy and free them from paranoia. So you've got that mix in there, and you've got a lot of mixes going on in the world right now, and it is just going to be too wild of a ride, Mr. Toad's wild ride, to be sure. Holy Spirit has indicated, sidestep it. Don't get caught up in that. Don't get caught up in it. So, again, saying, hey, work on your golf game, right? It's a metaphor for just don't get caught up in that. It's just more of the same. It's just more of the same. It has nothing to do with enlightenment. And so just stay with enlightenment. Just stay working on enlightenment, what it really is. Just stay with it, okay? So, yeah, that's an hour and a half. And a wonderful hour and a half. Thank you for spending it here with me. Just keep hearing this heads up. Keep hearing this heads up. Get wise, get wise, get wise. Learn from the mistakes of others. That's how you get wise. Don't repeat the mistakes of the past. All right. So we're very wise to this now. I'm wising up to it to extraordinary extent now. And I'm seeing, okay, though, so this is what happened. Wow, 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 wow. Much ado about nothing, actually. But I didn't get cynical about it. I said, no, I got to succeed. It's my destiny to succeed, so I'm going to. I just have to keep working at it. So don't let yourself get cynical. Don't let yourself get cynical. Just tell yourself, my destiny is to succeed. There's no doubt about it. So that's what's going to happen. Very great. That's it for this one.